You don't know what you've just done, because you don't know him like I do, since I had him under my command in the African army, as officer in charge of one of the units of my column. If, as you wish, you give him Spain, he's going to believe that it's his, and he won't let anyone replace him, either during the war or after, until he's dead. Good morning to everyone. I'm Piggytail Pep, and this is the Spanish Civil War. In this channel, and for the next 3 years, we'll follow, week by week, the Spanish Civil War, its battles, and the Holocaust that it provoked. Another intense week, maybe not in the field, as the Army of Africa has to reorganize before continuing its march, and in the north, the rebels had to stop as the arrival of the Republican fleet at the Cantabric Sea blocked their advance, following the coastline. In fact, last week the Republican Navy was sent to the north in order to support the Loyalist troops there. The squad that headed north was composed by most of the Republican Navy, with its most powerful ships. One battleship, the Jaime I, two light cruisers, Cervantes and Libertad, seven destroyers, and three Class C submarines. A formidable force. But also last week, two rebel cruisers, the Almirante Cervera and the Canarias, a heavy cruiser, probably the best ship of the Spanish Navy, even if it was not finished yet, had left the north and headed to the Strait of Gibraltar. This week, on Tuesday, they will attack two Republican destroyers, sinking one of them and routing the other one in what is known as the Battle of Cabo Espartel. Note that in 1782, during the American Revolutionary War, there was another naval battle there between a British and a Spanish fleet. But this is another story. Battle of Cabo Espartel that took place in 1836 meant the official end of the Republican blockade of the Strait of Gibraltar. Even before the arrival of Italian and German aid, that by the way was requested by Franco as an answer to this blockade, an airlift was established that poured men into Spain. Around 12,000 men had been transported by plane since the 20th of July 1936. With the end of the blockade, the first major airlift in history ends too. In the upcoming days, more than 6,000 soldiers will cross the strait, now by ship. The 28th of September, this Monday, the meeting of the junta that Yagüe and Nicolás Franco were pressing for will take place. When the newly minted Generalissimo Franco reaches Salamanca's airfield, he is received by a guard of honor composed by Carlists and Falangists, put together by General Quindelán and Nicolás Franco. They were ready to present their draft proposal for the new powers of the Generalissimo as head of state during the war. As you may imagine, the other members of the junta hesitate. There's an important distinction and gap between the chief of the army and head of state. And when Madrid will fall to the rebels, a new head of state will be chosen. So there is no real need for one right now. During the afternoon, Mola and Capo leave, but a new draft is being prepared by a professional of international law. Calls issued between Mola, Cabanellas and Capo, they have been outplayed, but the best part is yet to come. The draft linked the figure of Generalissimo to the head of the government of Spain while the war lasted. According to Ramón Garriga, who will become a member of Franco press staff, Franco himself deleted the sentence while the war lasted, which, by the way, turns out to be the title of a massive film about the Spanish Civil War. Apart from that, even if the document specified the role of Franco as head of the government of the Spanish state, he referred to himself as head of state. Most of the rebel press accepts this title, except for the Carlist Diario de Navarra and some southern newspapers. Their hopes, as the other monarchies' hopes, began to shake. The 29th, cameras from all over the world filmed Franco's triumphal arrival at Toledo and his meeting with Moscardó. The name Franco resounded everywhere. He definitively became the face of the rebellion. After the death of Sanjurjo, thanks to his brother's and other generals' works, Miss Canarias 36, the general that joined the rebels late, was already referring to himself as head of a new state. We will now leave the chapter of the siege and the liberation of the Alcázar behind, even if the repercussions of the liberation will become Franco's first great proof of legitimacy. There's even an Italian film about the siege. But before leaving this episode behind, we would like to consider a couple of things. First, the journalists were not allowed to enter the city until the 29th. The Red Terror claimed around 500 lives in the city. The repression unleashed by the rebel army was again dantesque. The wounded Republican soldiers at the hospital were killed, and nobody heard anything else about a group of hostages that the rebels kept inside the Alcázar. They vanished. The other thing we would like to mention before closing this chapter is that the 9th of September, Restituto María del Alcázar Valero Ramos was born, the kid of the Alcázar. During his youth, he will become a propaganda tool for the regime. As an adult, he will become an officer of the army and will be arrested in 1975 for being a member of the Union of Democratic Military Men, UMD, a pro-democracy gang inside the army. He was freed by the general amnesty after Franco's death, without a penny nor a job. He quoted his father, who joined the rebels of the Alcázar, in an interview. "They lied to us, told us that we were fighting against tyranny for a better Spain, and we found ourselves fighting for the same old tyrants." Retired Colonel Restituto Valero Ramos died the 24th of March 2020, victim of COVID. Rest in peace. The Junta de Defensa, which last week was still issuing decrees, like one forbidding any kind of trade union activity in their control zone, will be replaced by a state technic assembly, presided over by General Fidel Dávila. As Preston points out, it echoed the political organization under Primoz de Rivera dictatorship. From now on, the newspapers will have to carry the motto "Una patria, un estado, un caudillo," the Spanish version of "I'm Volk, I'm Reich, I'm Führer." Even though Germany makes it clear that it won't recognize Franco until he takes Madrid. So the rebel side is already united. A new state is being built. Capo de Llano will rule Andalusia as a warlord, but won't challenge Franco's will anymore, like he did when he shot General Campins. The 1st of October, Franco will be proclaimed head of the Spanish government. That was his speech. Generals and officers of the Junta, you can be proud. You received a broken Spain, and you now deliver up to me a Spain united in an unanimous and grandiose ideal. Victory is on our side. You give me Spain, and I assure you that the steadiness of my hand will not waver and will always be firm. We will ensure that there is no home without light or a Spaniard without bread. One day earlier, the 30th of September, the Bishop of Salamanca, Blai Daniel, published a long pastoral letter, The Two Cities, in which he associated, in terms of St. Augustine, the terrestrial city to the Republic and the celestial city to the rebel side. With this text, the idea of the civil war as a crusade that we've already seen in some priests before reached a new level of popularity, soon becoming a war cry for the rebels. Now, let's point out that Franco was not a very devout Catholic, but this was manna sent from heaven. Now, let's think about it. They have the same motto as the Nazi Germany, are getting help from Nazi Germany and fascist Italy, and they are continually trying to stop caps? I don't know, but they are probably fascists. The point is that they already had the fascist nations as patrons, but now, with Blai Daniel pastoral letter and the Pope text we've already talked about, they will get the support of Catholics worldwide. According to Preston, Franco's Catholic credentials opened doors that his fascist ones had closed before. Also in the rear guard, but the Republican one, some political movements take place. We saw last week the entrance to the government of a Basque nationalist politician. This week we'll see the approval of a Basque regional constitution, Estatuto. And that was their goal. Even for Catholics and conservatives in the Basque country, the Basque people sided with the Republic to obtain self-government. In Valencia, this week, the Iron Column, an anarchist column, assaults the prison of Castelló and kills 54 people. This column gained a very bad reputation, even though it was one of the most active columns in terms of cultural output and collectivization. Maybe this last aspect is linked to their bad reputation. The more collectivizations, the more killings. During this month, Valencia itself will suffer from the struggle of power between anarchists and socialists. It's becoming clear that the control of the administration of a state is linked to its repressive function in human affairs. So the anarchists will struggle and fight against the reconstruction of the new republican state, that in the end, it's a bourgeois state. So, also in the rear guard, this week in Madrid, a newspaper article appeared claiming that the previous Saturday, 125 people were killed in the city. After the article is published, 200 people are killed. Among them, the Catholic poetess Esther López Valencia. The Red Terror was also taking its cultural toll. The number of assassinations in Madrid has grown despite the government efforts to handle the situation. But we could see that there's a reason for it, and we will take a look at it during next week. As we will take a closer look also to the siege of Oviedo, because today, Sunday, 4th of October, with African reinforcement incoming, the rebels decided to proceed with full offensive to relieve the city of Oviedo. Before leaving you with the promise of coming back to the siege of Oviedo during the next week, we'd like to point out that the value of this African reinforcement heading north was very high. The regulares, the Moors, had a psychological impact on the battlefield, so everyone, from Cape on Varela in the south to Mola in the north, asked for reinforcements of this kind of troop. They were considered very reliable. Even a single company of these troops had an effect in the battlefield. Even more in these early phases of the war, when there is still a war of movement and loyal troops have almost no training. As today we've mentioned the death of a Catholic poetess victim of the Red Terror in Madrid, here you've got the link of the week when García Lorca was murdered. Please don't forget to like the video and subscribe. If you enjoyed it, please share it. We have to bring light to the history of Spain. If you are able to support us in our Patreon channel, as these heroes already did, or offer us a coffee, this would also be great and would help us to carry on and improve the project. Let's make this possible together. Thanks for your attention. Goodbye and salute.